If you would like to get your song reviewed, dear listener, there's the Filthy Capitalist option. It's where he says, 125 gets you straight to the head of the line. You don't have to be a part of the alliance. You don't have to be part of the group.
Wait a minute.
And the biggest thing is you don't have to wait. You hop, skip, and jump right in front of everybody. 125 gets you there. You do that 3 times, and then get mashed down to the $75 rate for perpetuity.
Yes!
Also, there is a band review option. So if you've got a band and you're trying to get your band some exposure, hit me up at insoria@gmail.com, and I'll show you the details about how to pull that off.
You can also jump on Patreon, and there is a option on the tiers to be able to get your band reviewed. Yep. Obviously, we can't lie to you, so we can't guarantee a positive review. Get what you get.
It's just rubbish.
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 That's British for garbage.
My favorite is the community option. $1 at the gate gets you into Patreon. You get to join an alliance. The alliance joins their points together, and that helps determine what songs that we do.
The alliances hang out on Discord.
Shh, message me on Patreon to get the link.
And they do all kinds of other cool things. They do Minecraft. What? Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah. It's really a community within the community. Anybody can go on the village, facebook.com/vinandsori. There's 160,000+ people on the channel. What's cool about the Discord is that it offers a real opportunity for community connection, friendship, that type of thing.
But, and it's on Discord, so if you're not a Facebook person, it's for you.
You start off at $1.
Right.
Plus you get exclusives. Sori and I are working on a song. So the first 15 seconds of that was on Patreon. Also, at $15 tier and above, when we actually debut the video, they're going to be there live with us. There you are, dear listener.
Buy our merch.
Buy our merch indeed.
And a child shall lead them.
Child shall lead them. Ah, there's Jambi with his bitterness. I love it.
Aww.
What's up, Jambi?
I've seen you guys give 10s to rubbish, MDF.
Rubbish! That's British for garbage!
Look, MDeath fan, that was your opinion that it was rubbish. I didn't think it was rubbish if I gave it a 10. I try to only give 10s stuff that when I want to go back and re-listen to them, they get 10s.
All right.
So I'm really trying to figure out my own playlist.
This is the ultimate super fragilistic Megadeth stream.
Megadeth. Every single song stream on this stream is Megadeth.
Crunch.
Megadeth the whole time, Megadeth.
Crunch!
So here we go.
Why are you trying to outshine me? All right.
I do that because sometimes you put your hand and it gets in my face and it annoys me, and I wanted to know if it annoyed you too.
Have,
and it doesn't look like it does.
Cool. Will Travel, Megadeth, and you're supposed to turn this up. Johnny Starr in the house.
This is the remastered version. It says, crank that shit. Turn it up.
Turn it up. What the hell?
What?
Wow. Okay, when did that record come out?
Oh, 1997.
June 1997.
June 17th.
Okay. First of all.
Special day.
What stood out to me was the chorus.
Really?
Yeah.
The last one, it was a solo. This one's a chorus.
Well, because vocally, it was perfect.
Oh.
Ooh. You know?
Yeah.
And like, what was it? There was one particular song when we first started reviewing Megadeth, it was like 2 years ago, and like he was legit trying to sing in the chorus, but he doesn't have a lot of vocal range, and it was just a disaster.
Oh no, I don't remember.
I don't know if it was Tornado of Souls or whatever it was.
Oh no.
But it was just it was horrifyingly bad. I was like, what the hell is this? Like, it affected our rating.
Yeah.
But this one, people were saying, well, it gets better later on. And like this chorus right here, I love it when people, because everybody can sing. Everybody has a range. Everybody can sing if you just stay within your range. Hmm. You know what I'm saying? So like when I was showing you that part for that song, I was out of my range.
Yep.
But you got the idea.
Yep.
But yeah, like so for example, the Kyrie Relea song, like the first part, that's in my range and I can do that with you. I can harmonize. It sounds great. But anything higher than that, forget it.
That's
so
cute.
So like,
ah, you're cute.
This one, he was right in his range, man. He really, really was.
And, yeah, I would agree with that.
Yeah, and I don't know who it reminded me of some kind of a grunge singer, but I forgot which grunge singer it was, but I love what he did in the chorus, but it reminded me, I don't want to say it was Eddie Vedder.
I was just going to say, was it Eddie Vedder?
No. And there's a specific kind of song I'm talking about, but the way he slowed down the tempo and then, the song's on the tip of my tongue, but
hey,
I can't.
Hey, Sadie, happy birthday.
Hey, happy birthday, Sadie. Good to see ya. Yeah, so I really, 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 really like that chorus. What stuck out to you on the song?
Just the kind of the way that it was, it had like not like a super heaviness, but it had like some heaviness to it. But then there was also some, I don't know how to explain it, but I liked what they did with it musically. And then what did you think that the song was about? It sounded
Mods.
Like it was
Mods. Zero. Just can you permanently ban this guy or what? Mods, get rid of him.
Which one?
Yeah, Layne Staley. It did have a Layne Staley feel to it. It did have a Layne Staley feel to it. For sure. Yeah, Layne. Okay, everybody's getting it. Okay, but keep going. What were you saying?
Are we talking about like violence in schools? Like it kind of reminded me of, well, not exactly like Chappelle's speech, but you know what I mean. Like
we were just talking
about topic.
Today.
Yeah, the topic.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, it's about school shootings.
That's
right?
Such a, yeah, God. Yeah. I can't even, you know, and to me, it was like kind of more of an upbeat song for such a horrific topic too. But I guess, how else are you going to get the conversation going if it's too heavy plus the topic's heavy? I'm not sure people would listen to it.
Yeah, by that time, it's funny. Columbine happened in 99. This song happened in 97. But there were other school shootings that happened prior to Columbine.
That was the first one I ever heard about.
Columbine was just the biggest one.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like still happening when the news was...
Yeah.
Yeah, his name is Windwar Attack. Like, permanently ban the guy. Get rid of him. But there were, like I said, there were other school shootings that were happening prior to that. And
why did that one make it so big onto the news?
Well, one was that it was still happening in real time.
Oh.
You know, I mean, literally the cameras got there and a kid was like climbing out of the window.
Oh my God.
I mean, he made it.
He did.
But yeah. But it was, I mean, he had broken the window and he climbed down and he got blood all over. It was just a horrible, Yeah, it was just on the next level type of thing.
Yeah, I remember we were teenagers and there was a youth conference and we were all at this youth conference and then they started talking about it. And I'm not sure if it was because it was I really don't remember if it was happening or if it had just recently happened and that's why they were talking about it. But that was the first I had heard of it, was at that youth conference.
Yeah, Overshadow Sean is an OG brother, so bring him back. But the Windwar guy, get rid of him. So you heard about it at a youth conference? Like, yeah. They stopped the conference and said, hey, this is going on?
The thing is, that's what I just said. I don't know if they said, hey, it's happening right now. I know that we were praying, so maybe it was going on right then. I don't remember a whole... I remember them talking about it. I think probably it hadn't... It had happened prior to that, but very recently toward that event. Because I remember them talking about the students and one of them being a Christian. So it must have already happened. But yeah, they were talking.
Cassie Bernal, there's a bunch of... Mm-hmm.
And her poetry and stuff like that.
Yeah. Okay, Overshadow. Yeah. Yeah, so there were school shootings before that. And it was crazy because the community had talked about it. Pearl Jam did Jeremy,
mm-hmm.
Which was about that.
And then
these guys, and then Megadeth did this song. And so, and he talks about it too. We the People point our fingers, blame, and wonder why. Which We the People is, you know, code for America. Mm-hmm. He's talking about American society.
Yeah.
Which you never really see people taking
any responsibility for what's happening over there.
Communal responsibility.
Yeah, right.
So
right.
Shout out to him for that, because most of the time we want to say, that's them, that's not me.
Yeah, I feel like that nothing is really being done to stop it. Like, remember that girl got up and she was speaking about it, and then all this mockery was happening about her. She has very short hair or something like that, and then she was getting mocked all over the place by grown adults
for this girl standing up and speaking. She was getting mocked by, like, hyper right wingers, because that's the problem. Every time one of these shootings happen, you get one side that says we need gun control,
mm-hmm.
and then you get another, and it gets completely politicized, and then you depersonalize the person. This girl had watched her friend's head get blown off.
Mm.
And so, you know, and look, I don't believe the solution is gun control, because America has 328 million people in it, and we have more guns than people. Mm-hmm. And so we're long past, you know, a gun control measure. You know, people bring up other countries and things like that. It's like, that's not America.
Yeah.
Like, America, it was built on the gun. Like, you, people don't understand. Like, the other thing is, like, it's an argument, really, from the greater to the lesser. Are you saying that a person would be willing to commit such a heinous crime as shooting people when they're in school? But then they'd say, you know what? I'm not going to do that because having a gun is against the law.
No,
it
just
doesn't make any sense.
No, I get what you're saying. I just think that, like, you know, when we're talking about, you know, like locks are just to keep the honest people honest. If somebody really wants to get into your car or they really wanted to get into your house, they're going to get in, you know, but the lock there just kind of keeps, you know, so my thought is, I think that, you know, kids and I do think that still some people would search out to find a gun, but I do think that more often, if the gun is accessible, they're more likely to use it. Like, hasn't it been a lot of these times the gun came from the parents' house?
Listen, the person who is the type of person that's going to shoot up a school is the person that would kick in your lock.
Yeah, but are they the
type? You see what I'm saying?
I don't know if they're the type of person that would go looking for a gun or not. You're saying you think they would be. Yeah, I don't know. I think that somebody came up in the ghetto. Just like your mind just kind of goes off. Like, how long did they plan this for? Did they just come up with it?
Came up in the ghetto.
Yeah.
In New York City, it's illegal to have a gun, especially if you're underage.
Yeah.
We all had guns. We all knew how to get them.
Mm-hmm.
See, that colors my understanding of gun control. Chicago has.
Yeah, but
a lot
of these school shootings are not happening in New York, right? They're happening like weird small towns and stuff, right?
Well, I mean, my point is, I've experienced areas where they made guns illegal and the places were flooded with guns.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, that does not stop anybody who wants to... If somebody wants to kill you...
Yep. They will.
A gun control law is not going to stop them. Mm-hmm. And to me, I didn't really have any sort of path to a solution until I heard Bernie Sanders on Joe Rogan. And I don't even think Bernie Sanders understood what he did when he talked about it. But and of course, MDeathFan is like, that's why concealed carry is good. Fuck around and find out. Yeah, but again, for people that are sending their kids to public school, I mean, what are you going to do? You're going to tell your kids to conceal carry against their classmates? Is this where we are?
Oh, my gosh.
Like, you see what I'm saying? These solutions, it's like one group is saying no guns, and then the other group is saying more guns, and both of them are equally ridiculous to me.
Yeah.
You know, the kid who's bent on like Columbine, for example, they planned that shit for weeks. They were going to bomb the school and shoot him up and do all types of crazy shit to him. They were, you know.
What's this? Did you want that?
No, not particularly. You can give that to Johan.
Oh, it's mine. I'm gonna use it. Thanks, honey.
But you know, like, so here is where I think Bernie inadvertently gave the solution. He was on Joe Rogan, and he was talking about Medicare for All.
Yeah. And right.
He was talking about how people,
right,
who have mental illness, can't go see a doctor or get the meds that they need to deal with the mental illness because they can't afford it. And so, and you know how, especially men, forget it. You know, you're not going to not go to work, and you're not going to burden your family with another medical bill just because you have something wrong behind the ears and all the rest. Men aren't going to do that. Mm-hmm. And so he said, you got all these guys that have all this mental illness. And of course, in America, who are the most, you know, inordinate victims of suicide are men. Mm-hmm. Because we don't get the mental health, you know, a woman is more likely to get mental health, and she's more likely to get meds than a man will.
Yeah. So, but you know what? Right now, during COVID, you know, I've heard a lot of people saying they're having a very hard time to get in to see any counselors or therapists or anything. And I'm pretty sure that there's like one counselor in school for, it was a crazy number. I was talking to somebody about that, and they were saying that it's so spread out. Like, okay, I want to say it was like one counselor for 300 students or something like that. Like, it was outrageous. Like, they're not going to be able to get the help they need. And I think that some of these classes that the kids have to do are just dumb. But I think that one of them that should be mandatory is mental health. And they should all be taking a class on what to do in a mental health crisis situation, so that can help them with themselves and it can help them with each other, and it will help them be able to see what's going on, because these kids are not stupid. These kids are very, very smart kids. So many teenagers have so much potential, and they're underestimated by their parents, by their peers, 100%. By their teachers. And I think that if we set these kids up to be able to help each other, I think the kids want to help each other. But they don't know what to do in different situations. And I think that they see there's something going on, they just don't know what to do about it. And there needs to be, you're right. You are absolutely right. There is a mental health crisis in our nation.
Yeah.
And there is not enough understanding of what to do or how to help people. You're right.
Well, yeah. He was talking about that. He was talking about that. And then Rogan says, let's talk about where we disagree. And then they start talking about guns and gun control. Mm. But Bernie didn't connect them.
Yeah.
And to me, that's where I say, okay, that's where we need to focus. I don't think the gun control laws are going to work. And even if you arm the security guards at school, I was in a school that had armed security guards. If you wanted to get somebody, the security guard wasn't going to do shit except for pick up your body. Trust me.
They want to get home to their family.
Yeah, it's not even that. Look, the security guard is not God.
We saw those, or was that the cops, that they didn't want to go in? They were waiting for
the SWAT team. Well, yeah, that's the other thing. In Colorado. yeah. Like, those kids were getting shot up, and that dude stayed outside because he had a little pea shooter, and the guy was I think he had an AR or he had a Bushmaster. No, it's a Bushmaster, I think. So like That guy is not going to, like, if somebody's trying to get a bunch of people, you're going to get a bunch of people before. And I get it, like, arm the teachers. Like, that introduces a whole...
No way.
That introduces a whole different... I've got a completely different perspective on that. I'm sorry. I don't want the white lady armed with a bunch of 16, 17-year-old young black youth. I'm sorry. I don't want that happen. Police can't even control themselves around us. And they're supposedly trained in it. But why... There's not a big conversation happening around mental health and the ubiquity of guns and how that works together.
Yep.
And I think that that's a major, major, major consequence, actually, of not having socialized medicine, actually.
Absolutely.
If you look at other countries, if something is wrong with you, you can go to the hospital and you won't feel like you're, you know, burdening your family with all types of craziness. And the way that Americans look at mental health, I mean, I think it's a lot better in this generation. But it's like, oh, toughen up, you know, yada, yada, yada. It's like, okay, he'll toughen up and kill all his friends. What about that? Like, you know, I really, really think that if we put out a real investment into mental health, that I think we would get back some seriously good returns.
Absolutely.
When it comes to the school shooter stuff.
Absolutely.
Or just active shooters in general. Like, you know, there's a sort of nihilistic despair that these people have that is obviously psychotic. And, you know, like, it's just one of those situations where that's where we need to be doing the focus. But because guns are so politicized, and guns have a symbolic effect on the mind of Americans.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
For sure.
You know, they have a symbolic effect of
Well, and I think that people are kind of old school in their thinking. Like, back in the day, the weapons of the people kind of match the weapons of the military. It's not like that anymore. Like, if the military wants to go after us, or whatever guns you have in your house, you're not going to be able to stop the government with your guns. Remember that picture when the people came out, like, the military was all, like, strapped up, and, like, they came out with their...
Yeah. It was the gravy. It was the gravy seals.
That's right. Yeah,
morbidly obese individuals who believe that they're going to overthrow the government because
they've got their gun. Yeah.
So I understand that part about it.
Yeah.
But I do think it's like, hey, maybe we can have a real conversation about mental health and the ubiquity of guns in America. And maybe we can overhaul our society so that we can encourage, especially men, especially young men.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's a very particular demographic who's doing the vast majority of these active shooters. Mm-hmm. Maybe we could get them mental help. But again, if you're a man, you're much less likely to go seek out mental help. And I agree, like, just throwing pills at it isn't the solution.
No, of course not. There's therapy that has to be done to help people work through the things that they have to work through to get the healing that they need to be able to be healthy human beings. And I think because, you know, people have traumas from childhood, they have, you know, they grew up with their parents who are, you know, just sinners like the rest of us. You know what I mean? Like, people have things that they have to deal with. And it seems like, you know, there was that athlete, I'm sorry, I don't remember his name, but he wanted to normalize, like, taking care of your mental health and being able to say, hey, I have this or that issue. It would be really cool if society would take a flip and the people that you were like, yo, were the ones that weren't in therapy.
Right.
The ones that wouldn't, that refused, that believed that they were, correct, that they could do their own therapy. Right. Those are the people that we should say, yo, wait a minute. You're the one I'm going to be worrying about. These people are working. These people are at the point where they're not in self-denial and they're saying, I need help.
Correct.
And I'm going to go talk to somebody who can help me.
Correct. 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 And I agree with Joe Garcia. Daniel Almeida says, weren't the Viet Congs able to resist the full might of the U.S. military? No. No, they were not. Ask any Vietnam vet and they'll tell you the ROEs became progressively more and more constricted as Jane Fonda and the rest of those folks demonized the U.S. military. Secondly, the Viet Cong were in a constricted war with the French, with European powers, for a very long time. So these are all battle-hardened people that all they knew was war. Mm. That's not the same thing as out-of-shape 30, 40-somethings who are cosplaying as Navy SEALs saying they're going to go and attack their own government.
Right.
It's not the same thing. Right. And to me, I think anybody in America, this is going to be controversial. If you are an out-of-shape individual who believes that because you have an Armalite Model 50, you believe that you're going to somehow resist the American government, that proves our point that there's a mental health issue.
Exactly.
Because anybody that knows anybody,
exactly,
or anything about military tactics, strategies, etc., knows that that's ridiculous.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
As AT said, we've got drones. We've got things that we've got classified shit. I mean, we've got.
Yeah.
If the United States military turned against its own people, trust me, your AR-15 is not going to help you. It's just not going to help you. And I think we've got to think through the mental health aspect of this, mm-hmm, and destigmatize it, particularly for men.
Yeah,
there have, yep, been female active shooters. But it's men almost 9 to 1, or it's males 9 to 1.
Right.
Why is that?
Right.
Obviously, we have, you know, we're you know, situated for more aggression and things of that nature. Mm-hmm. I get that, but I do think there's also a severe stigma on men who ask for mental health.
Yep.
I know it's huge in the Black community. I know it's massive in the Black community. Where, you know, Black women are kind of allowed to get mental health, but even they're not allowed to because the whole strong Black woman trope. Mm-hmm. But Black,
I think,
men,
religious context too.
Forget it. Same thing.
Jesus is going to fix all of that. Right. Jesus is your counselor. Blah blah blah.
It's true. Very, like, rarely do you, it's not these atheists. I mean, the Columbine kids were, but for the vast majority of it, it's not atheists running around blowing people away.
Yeah, I mean, I don't even know, like. Just because the kid themselves is saying they're an atheist doesn't mean they didn't come from a religious family that didn't believe that you should. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's plenty of kids that say, I'm an atheist because their family is so crazy religious.
Yeah. M. Death Finn. Stop being so weak. Stop being so weak. A lot to learn. No, I think M. Death Finn, you have a lot to learn. I don't think that a person admitting that they need help is weakness. I think that's strength, and I think
absolutely.
I think we need to reorient what it means to be man, a masculine individual, all the rest of it. And that's why I spend a lot of time talking about my own mental health issues, the things that I went, mm-hmm, through, being in the hospital, things, yep, of that nature.
Yep.
You know, I'm pretty secure in who I am as a man. You know, I've got a pretty exotic resume that I'll put up against anybody.
Uh-huh.
and you know what I'm saying?
Oh, for sure.
But yeah. I had severe mental health issues, and I needed the help. I couldn't do it on my own.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm glad that I was able to interface with people who, you know, my mother, because she's got a background in the medical field, she saw the signs of what was happening, and she made sure that I was good. And for me, because I'm such an extreme personality, I ended up in a hospital,
mm-hmm,
and I ended up there for quite a half a year.
Mm-hmm.
But it was necessary for me. Mm-hmm. I needed it. And it reset me, and it put me in a really, really good, you know, a really good trajectory in my life. And I was able to yep, recover and move on. It was one of the best things that ever happened to me. And that's one of the reasons I'm so explicit about that. Because we've got to destigmatize this for boys, because we're reaping the whirlwind. I, yeah, do not think that gun control is a solution. And I don't think arming teachers is a solution. You know what I'm saying?
No, absolutely not.
Guns, no guns, or no guns, whatever. That's not the solution.
Mm-hmm.
But I'll tell you something, M. Death Fan. If somebody would have said to me, suck it up, I said, Roger that. Roger that. Because I wasn't asking for help.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my mom imposed the help on me when I was a kid. Bless God. Thank God. But... this silly bullshit John Wayne ideology. That's the ideology that men and boys are dealing with.
Right. People end up dead in those situations. You know, there was a...
That's the ideology. So go for it. You know, do the whole, yeah, I'm an American, blah, blah, blah. Guns, yeah. And, you know, oh, it's just a flesh wound. I'll go on. Okay, cool. Do it. That's what we've been doing since the inception of this country. It's not working.
It's crazy, too, because if you see it in a religious context, it's very easy to say, that is so friggin' crazy. So there was this woman, she had cancer, and it was like in her arm. Her arm was completely black because there was so much in there. But and the people were telling her, like, you need to go to a doctor. You need to be seen. And she was like, there's nothing wrong with my arm. I prayed about it. God's going to, you know, God's healed it. It's completely good. So she just like stuffed her head in the sand about the fact. I mean, she did end up passing away because it overtook her. But in a religious context where she's spiritualizing it and she's saying, no, Jesus has this. He, you know, I'm good. He's got this. Ridiculous. When clearly that's not the path that Jesus wanted you to take. Ridiculous. I mean, he allowed us to understand modern medicine, and he set up the human body to be able to be understood scientifically so then we could actually do things to bring about change and healing in people. And it's no different when it comes to psychological stuff. Burying your head in the sand about it and manning up and not facing it is not going to actually help. It's going to end. In the end, it will bring death. Whether it's yours or somebody else's, it's going to bring death. Those kind of mindsets are not the type of mindsets that people can live out the longevity of their lives healthily and influence the people around them without it bringing some, you know, some form of chaos.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, to Sadie's point, we can always depend on her to be articulate. Mental illness doesn't just go away. It's not a matter of recover. It's a matter of address and find treatment, which is often ongoing. And,
right.
And a lot of times when you get, you know, like I said, I was blessed to be able, you have DBT, dialectical behavioral therapy. Mm-hmm. You know, they give you strategies. It's not just, you're in the hospital, we're going to pump you full of pills. At least that wasn't my experience. And that was, you know, over a decade, you know, 15 years ago. It wasn't just, we're going to pump you full of pills. They gave me real strategies. Hey, man, when this is happening, you can do X, Y, Z. It's not. It's a holistic way of dealing with things.
How many of those strategies do you still use now?
I do a lot of them, even unconsciously. I mean, even physiologically about stress, headaches, and things of that nature.
Yeah.
I still use a lot of them to this day. I've forgotten a lot of them, and if I, you know, I wouldn't mind doing a refresher of them, but... I don't think it's a crutch. And when he says, when you say we, I don't know what you mean. You know, because what we're talking about here, MDeath fan, is a very specific kind of issue. And the issue is, why are people, particularly white males, let's just be honest, why are they arming up with weapons, killing their friends, killing other students, randomly going into bars and shooting everybody up?
Right.
To respond to just say, well, let's just be John Wayne. It's like, that is a mentality that I think millennial, you know, we're at the back end of millennials.
Yeah.
I think the millennials are getting a lot better at this.
I think you're right.
They're a lot better at this.
I do think you're right. Yep.
There's not a lot of, and I don't know really the effect of social media. I would assume that you'd actually see more school shootings because of how toxic social media is.
No kidding. No kidding, yeah.
Because, you know, I told the story about my sister.
Right.
She almost took that girl. But, yeah. Like, and some of this has to do with how you were raised, too. I was raised in an area where there was a threat of gun violence all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, how easy it was for us to get guns... And how you feel when one of your friends, you know, gets shot, and the relative mania that you get put in.
Ugh, my word.
So like, I don't know necessarily, you know, MDeath came up in Chicago, but I don't know if he was dealing what we were dealing with.
Right.
But the temporary mania that happens when one of your friends gets hit.
Ugh, my word.
And you have open accessibility to guns, and you can get guns if you want. And that mixture of fear and the desire for vengeance for your folks, and how easy it is to get your hands on a gun, all that, what do you think, M. Death fan, all that John Wayne bullshit.
Right.
That machismo. What do you think is happening in that situation? Is that going to escalate or de-escalate the issue? See what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So to me, I'm not saying this about him, but it's this insecure, oh, if I don't act tough, I'm not really a man, you know, bullshit. You know, I've been around the world. I've done my share I've gone through all the rituals, the cultural rituals of John Wayne manhood more than most people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I've done irreversible things, yada yada yada. So it's like I don't even care about, you know, people's silly opinion about what men are. But how do we make it so that people don't just say, you know what, I'm just going to kill all my friends today?
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah, it's like Dave Chappelle said, like, kill everybody.
Have you tried skipping school? How about drugs? Try some drugs. But kill everybody?
Yeah.
Why? This makes no sense.
Yeah. So, and this right here is the essence of me and M. Death fans' debates. You know, I'm talking about that. And he goes, you want to move to Australia? That's me and M. Death fan every week. It's just ridiculous. Ridiculous. Those are the only two options. John Wayne or Australia. That's it.
I enjoyed this one, though.
Really good song. I think Dave did a good topic. Job.
Yeah.
We point our fingers, blame, and wonder why. And apparently we haven't learned very much from it.
Mm-hmm.
So there you go.
This one's a 9.6 for me.
I'm giving it a solid 9. I really, really did like that course. But the other thing about Dave is that when I look at these songs, he's kind of always saying something. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yep.
He's always saying, and you may not agree with Dave,
uh-huh.
but he's saying some significant shit.
Mm-hmm.
And Dave is one of those guys where, or I shouldn't say Dave, I should say Megadeth, because it's not one band. One man band, but
right.
He's one of those people that you could look at his discography and you could kind of match what's going on in America around him,
mm-hmm.
based on what he's saying. And I think that's like the mark of the true artist,
mm-hmm.
in my opinion. I'm not the biggest like Megadeth fan in the world, but now I'm sitting back. And I think about the songs and the concepts that he's talking about. Like, he's saying some real shit.
Mm-hmm.
For real, for real. Shout out to Dave Mustaine. Gang, gang. Okay. We're coming right back. If you're in regular YouTube world, I'm sorry. We're going to have to catch you at 3 o'clock or 7. Are we still releasing 3 minutes a day or something?
We were, but we needed more uploaded. So
okay.
We got a little, I think, 2 days of break.
Okay. So we'll be right back. If you're doing the right thing and you're in the stream, we're going to catch you in like 2 minutes. Vin out.
Sorry out.
Gone.